I did it. I achieved the impossible. I did what no human has ever done before. By reading the entirety of Game of Thrones in 24 hours. How did I do it? This is how. Hi everyone, my name is Holly and today I'll be doing my reading wrap-up, showing you all the books I have read recently and DNF'd recently. The year is coming to an end. I'm assuming this will be my last wrap-up for the year. Even though there's still a whole month left, I just plan on binging John Gwynn's books all December, and we already know how we feel about the Banished Lands. In fact, I'll be talking about one of them today. I have big plans for January, and I've been teasing one of them on a certain account recently. Wink, wink. Anyways, I already have another series picked out to read, but that's for a later video. So, let's go ahead and talk about what you're mainly here for. So, as a huge lover and fangirl of all things Game of Thrones, except for the final season of the show where they fucked up everything, I used to say that I have no right to include myself in the fandom for not having read the book. Well, now I do. In 24 hours, I read A Game of Thrones. Because of this. The graphic novels 1, 2, 3, and 4. As much as I want to read the novels, it takes a great commitment, which I could say I have most of the time as an adult fantasy reader. I read big books constantly, but Game of Thrones is a very different beast. It takes 5 pages for George R. R. Martin to explain what a freaking chair looks like, and my attention span is only this freaking big. I do highly recommend these, but I would not recommend it to first timers. If you've never read the books or have never watched a TV show, I think this will be really confusing to you. It skips out on a lot of detail that may leave things unexplained, transitions are non-existent, and can easily leave someone not in the know very confused. And there are so many characters, like if you are not previously prepared, you will likely get very, very lost. I have heard this follows much more closely to the books than the show, but it still really helps. Most of the show is amazing. The visuals in this are really pretty, especially the landscapes. I wasn't the biggest fan of how the characters are drawn. All the women look the same, and all the men look the same. But overall, the artwork does very well blending with the story itself. If you did watch the HBO series, and it has been a very long time, like it has been for me, since you've watched the first season, this will bring back a lot of memories, especially since all 4 of these covers the whole first season, and obviously very much a whitewash of the entirety of the first book. But that is the story these 4 contain. If you're someone who has absolutely no intentions of cracking open the original books, you can have a try at these. Oh, there is nudity in here, of course. It's Game of Thrones, and it is all women nudity, no men, which is disappointing. I gave volume 1 4 out of 5 stars, and the rest I gave 3 out of 5 stars. Alrighty, now that everyone is mad at me that I clickbaited them, let's move on. Valor by John Gwynn. My GoFundMe page will be linked down below in my bio to help fix my heart that is broken. What do I even say? If you haven't jumped on this series, basically if you were me a couple months ago, what are you doing? Especially if you love adult fantasy, if you love Joe Abercrombie, if characters are your thing, if that's what gets you going, get on this. This is the sequel to Malice. It's a 4-book series, plus there's another trilogy after, but this series in particular, The Faithful and the Fallen, man, it's rough on the emotions. The most striking thing about these books is how for 600 or more pages, it just builds and builds upon itself. You find yourself heavily invested in a lot of the characters, and the emotion really radiates off the page. I love these characters so much, and I've been extra savoring these books. They have consumed my entire life. It's all I'm reading, all I plan to read the rest of December. I did give this sequel 4 out of 5 stars. I think I found this one slightly slower than the first, which is really funny because many others have mentioned how Malice is the setup while this one begins the actual conflict, which I totally see and I agree with that. There was just a lot of travel time in the first half of this, but it's so funny how we can experience things differently like this. This is the kind of 4-star rating that makes me want to change every past rating I've ever done, because it far exceeds many other reads. And also, typically for me, the first book of a series, if I end up loving the series overall, will always be my favorite. No matter how good the other books are, I'm a first book bitch, what can I say? Okay, so being someone who was a big fan of Rat Queens, I was ecstatic to see Curtis J. Weeb publishing another fantasy-based graphic novel with a brand new artist, which is Dryad Volume 1, But I'll be honest, I was a bit disappointed with this one. The story is centered on two parents who are from the city. At the very beginning, they are running away from their past, which the reader is unsure of at this point, and encounter a somewhat secret village they believe to be safe to raise their two young children. This gave me major Saga vibes, which I'm not complaining about whatsoever, but there was something about it that I couldn't get into. I couldn't really get invested in the storyline or the characters. I felt the character development and world building ended up falling by the wayside, and as a result, the setting and side characters are kind of generic. I did enjoy the first half more than the second half. I wasn't a fan of the huge transition of coastly woodland village to super high-tech city. This book gave me some brief entertainment in the style of a mindless action movie, but that's about all that I got from it. Silver in the Wood. This is one of those short novellas from Tor. It came out a couple years ago, I believe, and I just wanted to give it a shot. Now, I don't read much from Tor. I'm really not a fan of their short novellas, and that's mostly what they publish. I really wish all of their great sounding books were longer, but this book reads like a forest fairy tale. It's a queer story that mostly revolves around Tobias, a giant who has lived in a cottage in the woods of Green Hollow for several centuries. If you're into the cottagecore thing right now, you should read this. Tobias has a pet cat named Pearl and an overprotective dryad called Bramble. He is occupied with the caretaking of the woods, which becomes a dangerous place for humans in the summer. Which enters our other character, Henry, a regular human, the new owner of Green Hollow, and an inquisitive scholar of folklore and mythology who likes lurking in the woods. As soon as I began reading this, I was entranced by the writing. It's beautiful, so it's a shame that I feel like she's restraining herself with some of the world building because there's only 100 pages to work with. I would have loved for Tesh to dive into the mythology of the world, Tobias's previous life, Fabian, and Tobias's relationship. Oh, and I wasn't especially happy with the climax and the ending, but again, if the book had been longer, I probably would have been okay with it. Overall, I gave this 3 out of 5 stars. I still really enjoyed it though. And then I picked up Drowned Country, which is its sequel, and unfortunately, I had to DNF it, which surprises me because I thought I was going to like it more. This one is almost 100 pages longer than Silver in the Wood. That should have been a good thing, but it's following Henry instead of Tobias. And I loved Tobias, so it was sad not following him here. He's still in the book, kind of in the background a little bit. In fact, Tobias and Henry must come together again when a young woman goes missing, possibly because of a vampire. I found this overall irritating and slow, and the whole vibe was different. It went from foresty cottagecore to complainy poopy town. And then I have The Search for Wendla. This book has been clinging to my bookshelves for years. It was the oldest book on my TBR, and one day I just picked it up and started reading it, and I read it in like 2 days. It's the first book in a middle grade trilogy. It's a wonderful read that blends fantasy, sci-fi, and even kind of dystopian a little bit. It's following 12-year-old Evanine, who has lived all of her lonely life in an underground sanctuary. She is looked after by a robot named Mother and has never encountered a fellow human being. All that she knows about the outside world is through holograms. This is a wonderful story with an adventurous heroine, a foreign planet, exotic creatures, and a mystery. It's nothing amazing or earth-shattering, but an engaging story with a lot of life lessons thrown in. I definitely think this is a great beginner introduction to the world of sci-fi for children, and that makes my heart super happy. So 5 stars for that alone, but for me, I gave it 3 out of 5 stars. And the last book I have here, I think, is Frost. This is a short book about surviving the apocalypse. It's also a tiny bit of a queer romance. It has started out good, but as it got closer to the ending, I was less and less invested in the story. The concept of the setting is interesting, but way underdeveloped. There is not much information provided about the surroundings of the characters, except the fact that it's bad, cold, and lonely. That's all you get. The plot is also really linear and simply follows the two characters as events happen to reinforce their budding romance. I gave this one 2 out of 5 stars. Nothing special at all, unfortunately. I feel like it needed a lot more work. So I think this wrap-up proves that Malice ruined the rest of my year. Every book I have read after finishing it has been garbo. Anyways, I hope you enjoyed this wrap-up. I know they're too far few in between, but I've really just been going with the flow with my reading. But hopefully once 2021 comes, it'll reinvigorate me. Subscribe if you haven't. Now is a great time to do so because my end of the year videos are starting soon. Like this video, it truly helps me out and I always appreciate it. And until we meet again, happy reading.